It says in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 13 through 15, or we can even read verse 16. It says, "And who is he that will harm you if you be followers of that which is good? But if you suffer for righteousness' sake, happy are you, and be not afraid of their terror, neither be troubled. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asks you a reason of the hope that is in you, with meekness and fear. Having a good conscience, that whereas they speak evil of you, as of evildoers, they may be ashamed that falsely accuse you of your good conversation in Christ." So what Peter's talking about, the essence of this passage of Scripture is this, is that you can pretty much expect, it's not really going to be an unlikely thing, that when you make the choice to give your heart to the Lord, when you make the choice to truly become a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, that there is going to be some persecution that's going to probably come your way. Amen. Sooner or later, when you truly make a decision to live for the Lord, there's going to be some level of persecution at some point in time in your life. It doesn't mean, I don't know, we've been talking about this a little bit here and there through the last few weeks, but it doesn't mean that you're going to end up giving your life necessarily like the Apostle Paul. It doesn't mean that you're going to find yourself in prison for preaching the gospel, but at the very least, you may very well, you're going to have people that are probably going to talk about you behind your back. And more than likely, the first ones that'll do it will be those that are closest to you, whether they be your real close circle of friends, amen, or whether they be your family members. Let me tell you something. When you've been running with the devil for a long time, now maybe some of y'all never ran with the devil, or at least you think you didn't, but when you were running with the devil for a long time, and then all of a sudden you do a 180 and you give your heart to Jesus, and you start saying, "I can remember the first, when I gave my heart to the Lord, I can remember what, 3 months later, I had moved out of Lafayette, and some of my old friends said, hey man, we're going to Houma, we're coming through there, we're picking you up." And you know what? I got in the car and I knew I shouldn't have got in the car, and I felt convicted for 2 days. And finally I said, "Man, y'all got to bring me back home to my sister's house because I'm not the same." And as we were in the car going from Houma back to Morgan City, they were having a conversation in the front seat as though I wasn't in the back seat. He said, "Hey man, you remember that dude Matt we used to hang out with? Remember how cool that dude, how much fun we would have whenever we would party with that guy, man? Yeah, I heard he got, you know, just talking about how he got religion and how, man, it's like, you know, and just basically, there was a little form of persecution, you know, and I can just remember sitting in the back seat feeling really uncomfortable about really what, more so about what I had done that particular weekend. So all I'm trying to get at is that those that were closest to you, when you make a decision to turn your heart over and give your life to the Lord, it starts to cause something in their life to make them uncomfortable. You understand that, right? I can remember times whenever I would just be talking about Jesus because I was excited about the things of God. I can remember, I mean, Aaron, you might not remember, but I can remember back whenever you and I used to just talk about the Lord many, many years ago. We just get excited, man. We were just talking about Jesus, and we would just have a conversation, and I can remember people being uncomfortable because we were talking about Jesus. I thought we were preaching at them, when really all we're doing is talking about Jesus. Amen. You understand what I'm getting at? Whenever the Lord shows up and begins to deliver you and begins to do some things in your life, and your heart now begins to fall in love with the Lord, all of a sudden there's an abundance of hope and abundance of faith that rises up on the inside of you, and guess what? It starts spilling out of you. Amen. And it starts affecting other people. Amen. And people that maybe aren't really living for the Lord or loving God the way they should, they start getting convicted. All of a sudden they think, "Well, you don't have to preach to me. Why ain't nobody preaching to you? What are you talking about? I'm just talking about Jesus. That's all." You automatically think I'm preaching to you. Or then those that don't know the Lord, "Oh Lord, help me now." Those that are your family members, they're like, "Well man, you used to be just like us." That's right, but I ain't no more. But you know what he said though? He said this right here in verse 15. He said, "Always be ready to give an answer to every man that asketh you the reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear." I just want to remind you, it says meekness and fear. That was 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15. It said with meekness and fear. In other words, you're not supposed to be haughty. You're not supposed to be arrogant. You're not supposed to say it in such a way that you look down on people. But instead, what you and I need to understand is this, is that on this earth, there are people that are going through some things, just like the fact that you're going through some things. And when you sanctify, see, it says right here, to sanctify the Lord always in your heart. Sanctify. You know, back in the old days, back whenever I used to first start preaching, people would fuss at me and say, man, you use too many church words. You know, it's not a church word, it's a Bible word. And you know, we're supposed to know Bible words, amen? And what the word sanctify means, and one idea behind it is that it means holy. But the main idea right here is that it means separate. Now, I've talked to you about this before, but man born of Adam is born broken and dead, right? But that God has a plan, and the plan is that he gave his son Jesus, and Jesus died on the cross, and now when you put faith in what Jesus did, faith in Jesus Christ, and what he did for you at the cross, guess what happened? See, you were born broken and dead like Adam in this fallen world. But when you got born again, you got translated from the world into a new realm, a new environment, a new atmosphere. It's a place called in Christ. And what I need you to know is that a separation took place. You used to be here, born of the broken, fallen world. Now you're here, born again in Christ. Does that make sense? You got a new place, a new neighborhood that you live in, a new dwelling place, and the place is called in Christ. And so you've been separated out. Now what the Word of God's teaching us right here is that we are to sanctify the Lord in our heart. What does that mean? There's supposed to be a separated, special place for Jesus on the inside of your heart. You know, whenever you run into somebody that has a sanctified place for Jesus in their heart, it becomes real clear. You understand what I'm getting at? Like, in other words, when you talk to somebody that has separated the Lord out in their heart, I'm not talking about anybody being perfect up in this place. I'm talking about people that are in love with the Lord. People that have had an experience with Jesus. People that have said, no, Jesus is the number one thing in my life. Whenever that happens, it becomes real clear because they've separated a spot for Jesus in their life. And without a doubt, there's going to be a topic of conversation. And at some point in time, Jesus is coming forth. Always be ready to give an answer for the hope that is within you. Because people are going to know, and when you sanctify Jesus in your heart, you're going to have an answer to give them about the hope that is in you, that hope which is Jesus. You know, there's a story in the Bible, and that's really where I got the concept of the storm having to do with the song that they sang. And I love this story, and I've preached it many times. It's out of Acts chapter 27. I'll probably go to a couple of different verses, but in reality, I don't want to read the whole story to you. I just kind of want to tell you about some of what was going on, and I just kind of want to maybe point to a couple of verses. But in Acts chapter 27, it's nearing the end of the book of Acts. Y'all familiar with the book of Acts? It's a story about how the early church started. It comes after the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And now the church is being built. Amen. On the first part of it, Peter is the main character that the Bible talks about. Towards the end of it, Paul is the focal point as the disciples go forward and preach the gospel and the church is being built. Well, the mighty Apostle Paul has been traveling all over the Mediterranean Sea preaching the gospel. He's been a prisoner of the Roman Empire for at least a couple of years. And now, because he's a Roman citizen, he appealed and he said that he was going to go see Caesar. See, God always said, I'm going to bring you to Rome. And Paul just didn't necessarily know exactly how he was going to be there. And so in the midst of Acts chapter 27, the story goes that the Apostle Paul is placed as a prisoner on a boat. I preached about this a couple of months ago. I don't know if you remember or not. But he was placed as a prisoner on this boat, and he was going to be transported to Rome. Now, what I did want you to see was this, is that, and I mean, if you can put all these passages up, that's fine. But if not, I'm just going to explain it to you. In Acts 27, verses 1 through 7, and it would be hard to highlight it on the screen, and I don't really want to read all of it. But in verse 1, it says, that we. In verse 2, it says, we launched. In verse 4, it says, and when we had launched. In verse 5, it says, when we had sailed. In verse 6, it uses the pronoun us. And in verse 7, it says, and when we had sailed slowly many days. What is the point that I'm trying to make? The pronoun us and we is used 8 times in those verses of Scripture. What does that mean? You know who wrote the book of Acts?
Luke.
Luke wrote the book of Acts. And so what that means is that Luke was a historian. Not only was he a physician, but he was a historian. And he chronicled the beginnings of the early church. But what I need you to know is that because this is the first time that he uses that pronoun right there. Basically, what he's saying is I joined the journey. I joined the journey. I was on the boat. See, before this time, I'm just going around trying to find out the story. I got to find out the story of this Jesus that changed my life. The Lord put it on my heart, the Holy Spirit, to chronicle the beginning aspects of the early church. And I'm going to write it down. But there was a portion of time when I was doing my investigation that I joined the journey with the Apostle Paul. I got on the boat when he was a prisoner and headed to Rome. And he said, and I sailed on this voyage with him. I want you to know the reason I point that out is that on this ship, in this storm, in the midst of this mess that they encountered, there were both believers and unbelievers alike. And I got to tell you something, that on this journey, in this earth, when the storms arise, it affects both the good and the bad. It affects both believers and unbelievers, because you and I still have to navigate on a fallen earth. And you and I still find ourselves sometimes in the midst of stormy seas. But what I need you to understand and what I need you to know is, like Peter was told by the Holy Ghost, write it down. Always be ready to give an account for the hope that is within you. Because you need to understand something. The world out there doesn't have any hope. They're trying to look for a hope in all kinds of different places and all kinds of different areas. But the reality of it is, if they don't have Jesus, they don't have hope. And so what it says right here is that in verse 10, they began to set sail. And in verse 10 and verse 11, the Apostle Paul says this. Paul stood up and said unto them, sirs, I perceive that this voyage will be with hurt and much damage, not only of the lading and ship, but also of our lives. Nevertheless, the centurion believed the master and the owner of the ship more than those things which were spoken by Paul. So what we see here is we have a situation where we have an owner of a ship and who has all this precious cargo that he has to deliver. You know, he's a businessman. He's got a lot of money invested in this situation. And we have a centurion, a Roman soldier, who's in charge of over 100 other soldiers. But his job right now is to make sure Paul gets to Rome. Well, Paul stands up in the midst of that situation. Now, who is this? Who is this Apostle Paul? By all standards, we believe that he wasn't anything special to look at. His name, Paulus, in the Greek means small. People believe that he probably was small, that his name fitted. And he even says that in one of the letters he wrote, I'm pretty sure it was Galatians, that they say that his words are weighty, but yet his appearance is uncomely. He's nothing to look at. And who are you to stand up and to tell us how we're going to operate our business? Some new Christian, whatever the case, that's been arrested and you're on your way to go to Rome to see Caesar, why should we listen to you? Have you ever tried to talk to people out there in the world about the things of God? When they find themselves in the midst of situations and circumstances and they don't really know why it is that they're going through things, amen, and you try to take the opportunity to tell them the good news about Jesus Christ. Have you ever done that? Amen. Have you ever noticed how sometimes you'll find people that are very willing to listen, and yet sometimes you'll find people that you lose them because they just kind of glaze off into another world, right? I got to tell you something. Don't ever stop speaking the truth whenever you feel as though God has put it on your heart. Because just as the Apostle Paul experienced it, you will experience too. They didn't listen to the Apostle Paul. They set sail and they continued on in the midst of this journey. And what ends up happening is this. It says that really the storm started. It wasn't long after they went. And I want you to see in verse 17 right here. It says, which when they had taken up, they used helps, undergirding the ship and fearing lest they should fall into the quicksands, straight sail, and so were driven. So the storm's already started. It talks about undergirding the ship. I explained this whenever I preached it a few months ago. What that means is they floated ropes under the ship. They grabbed them on the other side. They pulled them up and they tied ropes on the top, trying to hold this boat together. This is how bad it's getting, right? Like, I mean, the waves are crashing. The wind is howling. They float ropes up under the boat, trying to tie this thing together, bring the sail down. We don't want no wind thrusting us, and we're going to be driven into this sandbar, quicksand, whatever the case, because we know that it's right here, and we have no control of this ship. We're about to get stuck. We're about to be shipwrecked. And listen to me, not only that, it goes on to say in verse 19, the third day, with our own hands, we cast out the tackling of the ship. That's a problem. That means all of the hoists, all of the pulleys, all of the things that you have to use in order to be able to rise or lower a sail, they started taking that stuff with their own hands. And then he's saying it with our own hands. It doesn't make any sense in the logical, because once this storm's over, what in the world are we going to do? We're just going to be floating around out here. But we were desperate. We had to get rid of all the unnecessary weight that was in the way, and they started slinging that stuff out. It goes on to say at some other point that they began to take actually the cargo of the ship. And they began to throw it out. Their whole purpose and everything for getting on this journey is now being abandoned, and they're just throwing everything out. I need you to know, but look at this right here in verse 19. It says, in the third day we cast out our own hands the tackling of the ship. Verse 20. And when neither sun nor stars in many days appeared, and no small tempest lay on us, all hope that we should be saved was then taken away. Now, what I need you to understand, and what I wanted to point out to you, is that the person who's writing this is Luke. All hope that we would be saved had now been lost. Sometimes you can find yourself in the darkest of storms, so dark that you can't even see the stars in the sky, you can't even see the sun during the day. You understand what I'm talking about? I'm talking about a dark storm that has brewed up in your life, and it can be so bad that sometimes even believers begin to lose hope. They begin to lose hope that there's no way towards salvation. Sometimes it's because people have been exposed to false doctrine and they've been taught to put their faith in everything but the right thing, which is Jesus, amen, the anchor that holds beyond the veil. And they've put their faith in every other thing that money can buy or that man's wisdom can give. And it all keeps falling apart because it's not God's plan. And if you've ever given your heart to the Lord and you've ever said that you loved him and wanted to live for him, I can assure you he will make sure that storms continue to brew to get your heart and your mind to continue to be focused upon him. Amen. In the midst of your life. Amen.
Amen.
So Luke, and sometimes it's about false doctrine, false religion, false things that we put our hope and trust in, but sometimes it's just that we need to be reminded.
Amen.
Amen? Amen. And listen to me, I don't care how long you've been a Christian, I don't care how much of the Bible you know, sometimes you and I just need to be reminded. Amen. Hold on in the midst of the storm, keep your faith in God's plan.
Amen.
Which is Jesus Christ. Amen?
Yes.
But after long abstinence, it says that Paul stood. I mean, I'm just thinking to myself, in the midst of all of this, the Apostle Paul spoke on the front end. He said what needed to be said, right? But nobody listened to what he had to say. And so now in the midst of this storm, he's watching all of this. It's not like he's been taking a nap through it all. He's watching all of this. He sees everybody scurrying around on the deck. He may have even helped them. He might have even helped them throw some of the stuff out. Who knows? You know? You know, they're like, hey, prisoner, help us. But he's watched. But after a long abstinence, he finally stands up again. And he begins to speak. And you know, there have been times in my life, and I'm sure if you've been walking with the Lord long enough, that there's been times in your life when you've tried to speak things into people's lives. Amen? And you could tell that they really did not want to hear what it was that you were speaking. And I can remember that there's been times in my life that I've said, after I've spoken on multiple occasions to people, whether it was leadership in other churches or just to other Christians, and I would say to myself, I'm not going to say it again, Lord. I'm not doing it. I keep doing what I feel like you're asking me to do, and every time I do it, it causes more trouble. I don't know if it's because I'm doing it the wrong way. See, I'm looking at it as though it's all my fault, and then the next thing you know, it comes back again, and I can't shake it, man. I'm telling you, there's something on me, driving me. You got to say this. You got to confront this situation. You need to speak this to the people that I'm asking you to speak it to. Well, I'm not doing it, Lord. I'm not. I already said I wasn't going to do it. He said, no, you're going to do it. All right, Lord, if it's you, I'll do it. And each and every time you stand up to do it, sometimes things just get worse. But I just want to encourage you that once again, don't quit saying what God has called you to say. But Amen. There will be times. There's a season for everything under the sun. We learned that in the book of Ecclesiastes. Solomon said that. There's a season for everything under the sun. Sometimes we are to keep our mouth shut. Sometimes we are to speak. Amen? It's for us to be able to hear the voice of God and to do it the way that it is that he's asking us to do. Nevertheless, after a long abstinence, Paul stood forth in the midst of them and said, "Sirs, you should have hearkened unto me." In other words, you should have heard what I said, and not just heard it, but been obedient. "You should have hearkened unto me and not have loosed from Crete, and to have gained this harm and loss. And now I exhort you to be of good cheer, for there shall be no loss of any man's life among you, but of the ship." We're going to lose the ship, but no man's life is going to be lost. "For there stood by me this night the angel of God, whose I am and whom I serve." I love that. He's not talking about, I don't belong to the angel, I don't serve the angel. No, what I'm trying to tell you is, the angel of God showed up. Amen. And the God that this angel belonged to, I serve him and I belong to him. And this angel showed up in the midst of this mess, and he spoke a word to me, saying, "Fear not, Paul, you must be brought before Caesar, and lo, God has given thee all them that sail with thee. Wherefore, sirs, be of good cheer, for I believe God, that it shall be even as it was told to me." And so the Apostle Paul, after a long abstinence, stands up in the midst of this storm that's raging, right? The darkness of the sky is so bad that even the physician Luke, who's a born-again believer, and God used him mightily to write the book of Acts, has also, along with everybody else, lost hope. There's no hope for our salvation. Yes, they're talking about the physical hope of salvation, but in the same sense, there's a truth in the spiritual that sometimes when people are in the midst of darkness and they don't even know what it is that they're looking for. Listen to me, I keep saying it, but I can't shut up about it. If you would take the time just to talk to people that don't know God, you will find out just how little that they know. The more you learn about the gospel and understand the covenant that God has provided, the more you're going to begin to realize that people are so clueless out there about the things of God that they're so lost, and God desires to use us as vessels to speak forth the truth of the gospel to them, to plant seeds in their lives so that they also might be a hope. I just love the way that he said that. "Wherefore, sirs, be of good cheer, for I believe God that it shall be even as it was told to me." I got good news for you, church. And because I believe God, amen, I believe the word that he spoke to us in this word right here. And what I mean by that is that sometimes you're going to find yourself in these very storms. Sometimes the storms are going to be dark, but I'm here to tell you this morning, I believe that what God said. He said, "Paul, you're going to make it to Rome. You're going to stand before Caesar." You know why? Because that was part of God's plan for Paul's life. Because Paul was going to go to Rome. He was going to witness Jesus there. He was going to preach Jesus there. God was going to use him mightily. And God is going to cause things to happen for his plan to move forward in the midst of humanity. It may not always be exactly the way that you want it to be.
Amen.
Let me tell you something, Christian. You need to be careful. You need to be careful that you don't have the mindset in your heart and in your mind that you are going to run off and quit, or you're going to do whatever it is that you're going to do whenever things don't always go exactly the way that you want them to go. The God that you serve knows your heart, knows your mind, knows you better than you know yourself, and sometimes he may not let you have what it is that you want to have for the very purpose that you don't need to have what you want to have, because if you got it, it would destroy you.
Amen.
I can remember times growing up. Well, you know, it just is what it is. I don't see her in here, but Isabella, man, I'm telling you, she was completely different than Sierra. I'd ask you, tell Sierra something. She, for the most part, she'd say, yes, sir. I'm not saying I had to spank because I did. But she didn't like getting spanked. Isabella didn't seem to care sometimes. And I would tell her, you can't have it. Why not, Dad? I said, because I said so. Well, Dad, I haven't asked for anything. Yeah, but sometimes you just need to hear the word no. And the reason why, and I told her this, I said, because the reason why you need to hear the word no is because you always getting what it is that you want. And one day, for no reason other than this, you're going to be married to somebody. And for that poor guy, I need to tell you no every now and then today. Because if you think that old boy is going to be able to just give you everything, you better marry somebody that's a multimillionaire if you think you're going to always get what you want. No. Sometimes you got to hear the word no. And when you hear the word no, don't get mad. Don't, stomp around like a little child and throw a temper tantrum. Or if you do, at least get over yourself. Amen. Praise God. Lord knows that I throw temper tantrums still. God help me. But, get over yourself. Grow up. And let's just keep moving forward with the kingdom. The preacher is going to get you mad sometimes.
Amen.
And sometimes it'll be because he's preaching the truth and you just don't like it. And sometimes it'll be because you don't like him. Or it'll be his fault. But guess what? You're going to just quit just because the preacher's imperfect too? No. Amen. We're all imperfect people.
Amen.
Growing in Christ. Learning how not to be so sensitive whenever things don't go our way. I'm supposed to be talking about hope this morning. Listen to me. In the midst of darkness, in the midst of stormy seas, when there seems to be no hope, when all hope is lost, hallelujah, God's got a word. He's spoken a word, and there's hope, amen, in the midst of the situation. Romans chapter 4, verse 16. This is another spot where the word hope showed up. Romans 4, verse 16. It says, therefore it is of faith that it might be by grace. Now, what is that talking about? I mean, I can tell you that this whole passage is talking about the plan of God. Remember in that song, it also talked about his covenant, his blood. Amen. God talked to Abraham. I know many of you know that, but I'm just trying to help you also interpret Scripture when you read it. You know, it's not just my job just to stand up here and preach. I want to make sure you understand the Bible. God told Abraham in about 2000 B.C., he said, come out of your father's house, and I will make you a great nation. I will bless those who bless you. I will curse those who curse you. And through your seed, all nations of the earth shall be blessed. 2,000 years before Jesus ever showed up on the face of the earth, God had already given a promise to Abraham. There was no nation called Israel. Understand that. There was no nation called Israel, but God promised that through Abraham he would give a nation, and ultimately through that nation he gave us Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
And it says right here, therefore it is of faith that it might be of grace. See, grace flows through faith. Hallelujah. Grace is something that you and I need that's given by the Holy Spirit to us in the midst of circumstances, in the midst of life events where we need the grace of God, we need the power of God moving and operating in our lives. And the way that grace moves, the Holy Spirit gives grace. And the way that the Holy Spirit gives grace is through faith. Not just any faith. It says right here, to the end that the promise might be sure to all the seed. Not to that only which is of the law, talking about those that were just Jews. So once again, Abraham, before there was ever a nation called Israel. See, because when Israel came about, I know that something, listen, I'm just doing a little teaching right now, just bear with me. When Israel came about, they said, we be Abraham's seed. In other words, they got all these other Gentile nations around here. You know what a Gentile is, right? Anybody that's not a Jew. Got all these other Gentile nations around here, and they don't know nothing about the God of Abraham. God created us 400 years later after the promise that he had given to Abraham, and he made us a great nation. We be Abraham's seed. And then they started looking at the law that they were given, and they thought they were the only ones that God was saving because they were the special people of God. And they were the special people of God. But they got their eyes off the fact that God called salvation in Abraham long before there was ever an Israel, long before there was ever a law. And the scripture right here, Paul's making the point that the scripture wasn't just for those that knew the law, but it was for all the seed. All those that would be the children like Abraham, who was the father of faith.
Amen.
Because God, Abraham believed God and his word according to the plan that he would have. It said, not only which is of the law, verse 16 towards the end, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations before him whom he believed, even God, who quickeneth the dead and calleth those things which be not as though they were. What does that mean? God's got a promise. He gave it to Abraham. And the God that gave this promise to Abraham, what does he do? He quickeneth the dead. What does that mean?
Brought him back to life.
That's right. He can make dead things live. Amen. That's what the word quickeneth means in the King James. It's old King James version word. It means alive. Quick means living. Amen. You ever watch that movie, The Quick and the Dead? It was an old Western movie. It comes on TV every now and then. That's what it means. The live and the dead. Quicken. And so the God that promised Abraham this makes dead things live. He calls things that aren't as though they are. You can do that all day long if you want to. That's what the whole prosperity message was built on. The whole word of faith message was built upon. Was speaking things into existence by the power of your own words and tongue. But I'm here to tell you, you can sit there and try to speak stuff into existence all day long if that's what you want to do. But look what the scripture says. It's the God that calls those things that aren't
Amen.
As though they are.
Amen.
Now, don't get me wrong. There is power in your tongue. Amen. And you have a positive confession. You're a child of the God of glory. Amen. But the point that I'm trying to make is this. You got to line up according to what God's word
Amen.
When you're speaking the word. And he says right here, before him whom he believed, even God who quickens the dead and calls those things which be not as though they were, who against hope believed in hope. Why was it against hope? Well, look what it says. That he might become the father of many nations. See, Abraham's promise that God gave him had to come to pass in order for the plan to go forward, because we needed an Israel through which Jesus would come. Does that make sense? And so, but against all hope, he hoped. What does that mean? No, there was no hope. He was 99. Do you remember the story? He was 99. Sarah was 90. Her womb was barren. And yet God had promised him that he would have a child, a promised seed named Isaac. There was no hope. When you look around, how in the world is this going to take place in the natural sense? When Luke looks around and the sky is so dark that you can't see the stars in the midst of the sky, how in the world are we going to find salvation in the midst of all of this? How? There's no hope. But yet Abraham believed in a God, hallelujah, that causes dead things to live. And he knew that the God he served could speak things into existence that even though he couldn't see it, hallelujah, God could say it and it would come to pass. Just like the Apostle Paul had a different vision than everybody else on that boat. God spoke and he chose to believe what God was saying, hallelujah, in the midst of that storm. It says in verse 19, and being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body, now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He trusted God in the midst of all of that. Even when it was against nature, when it was against all physical circumstances, the ability for any hope there to be. You know, it's not unlike the God of glory to do that very thing. You know what I'm getting at? For him to wait, just like the Apostle Paul waited after a long abstinence before he stood up and spoke again. It's not unlike God to be silent sometimes. He's already spoken a word before, but we didn't necessarily listen. It's not unlike him to be silent for a period of time and to allow all types of things to take place. People over there tying ropes around a boat, throwing stuff overboard, Abraham trying to bring forth the promised child. He ends up bringing forth Ishmael as he goes with not Sarah, his wife, but Hagar, the Egyptian bondmaid. In other words, people trying to fix their external circumstances on their own, figuring stuff out. You know what I'm talking about. Oh, we got to make it more real for me, preacher. Okay. You already got financial difficulties. And you feel as though you got to get a new vehicle, and instead of buying something for $6,000 that you can afford to, you can get your finances squared away, you can actually afford a $250 car payment. So you go and you put a, you get my point, now you pay much more money. And that's just one example of just somebody that's maybe dealing with something financial, trying to fix and remedy situations instead of waiting on the wisdom of God in the midst of a circumstance, whether it be a relationship issue. You know, it's like, oh no, I've always had a relationship. I want to be in a relationship. Instead of waiting on God, waiting on the voice of God to lead and guide you in the right direction, you take matters in your own hands, you go grab a hold of your own thing, and now the next thing you know, you got a bigger mess on your hands than what you had before you first started the situation to begin with. All I'm trying to say is that we got to learn how to wait upon God, amen, and to hear his voice in the midst of the circumstances. Amen. Now, it's not uncommon for God to wait until all natural abilities, everything in the physical is exhausted. Amen. When tying the ropes around the boat don't work and throwing everything overboard doesn't work, hallelujah. Whenever Abraham can't produce it in his own strength and Sarah's womb is dead, next thing you know, the God that speaks dead things into existence shows up. He does it supernatural and he brings hope. Amen. When there is no hope. You know, there's darkness in both of these circumstances. I mean, there was darkness in the sky and Luke couldn't see the stars. There's darkness right here in Abraham's situation because God's given him a promise and he's not seeing it come to pass, if you remember the story. But I got to tell you that God is also, not only is he a God of hope, but he's a God of light. He brings light in the midst of darkness. Amen.
Amen.
That's what the whole plan was for God to send Jesus upon the earth. We talked about that last week, right? That God's love comes from another realm. God's love comes from a whole other realm, another kingdom, something that's foreign to you and I, something that you and I don't really even understand. But John the Baptist's daddy, and I mean, I'm not going to turn there, but I mean, if she can beat me to it, that's cool. She can put it up there. Luke 1:79. John the Baptist's daddy, Zacharias, Whenever he actually, his mouth was open, he began to prophesy. And what he said was this. This is John, he said of his son John, that he was going to be a prophet for the Lord who was coming. And he said this is what the Lord was going to do. He was going to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death to guide our feet into the way of peace. There's darkness in the story in the book of Acts. There's darkness and a lack of hope in the situation that's going on with Abraham. But I'm here to tell you that the God of glory has sent light. He sent Jesus into the midst of our lives to lead and guide us, to show us the right way, to show us the right path. Amen. So there's hope on the path that God has provided. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 14, 15, and 16, the scripture talks about the fact that you are the light of the world. See, Jesus was the light, amen, that came from another realm upon a world that was filled with darkness because of the fall of man. Does that make sense? But the Word of God says in John chapter 1 that he was light and his light was the life of men. The scripture says now that you are the light of the world. Well, how did that happen? I thought Jesus was the light of the world. Well, he is. But whenever you got saved, his light was placed in you. He transferred his light into the midst of his believers. You are the light of the world, he says. And he said a city in verse 15, a city on a hill cannot be hidden. He says, neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candle, but they don't hide it. And then he goes on to say, a city on a hill cannot be hidden. And then he goes on to say in the next verse, it says that you and I are to let our light shine before all men, that it might glorify our Father in heaven. Amen. So I just want you to know that in the midst of this journey that we're on, in the midst of darkness, God has brought light. He put his light on the inside of us. Amen. And that there's people out there who don't know anything about that light.
Amen.
Amen. As a matter of fact, I want to share with you. We're getting close to the end here. Let's turn to Ephesians chapter 2.
Oh, goodness.
In Ephesians chapter 2, we're talking about, just remember what I said earlier, that in this journey and whenever we find ourselves in storms of darkness and we're looking for hope, even when there's not hope, there seems to be no hope, that The fact of the matter is this, is that there's both believers and unbelievers that are dealing with these situations. Don't ever think yourself more high and mighty than what you ought. Don't ever think that you can't find yourself in the midst of a trial or a storm where you actually will find yourself starting to lose some hope. But in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 12 through 14, the Apostle Paul encourages us and he explains to us and reminds us where we used to be. It says that at that time you were without Christ. He's talking, see, the church of Ephesus, I'm not trying to get all technical on you, but you know what? Sometimes it's better to be able to have a visual. Whenever I draw my little map of Israel, that here's the Sea of Galilee, here's the Dead Sea, here's the Jordan River. Israel was this landmass in between, right? This is the Mediterranean Sea right here. Y'all knew that? Up here was a landmass called Asia Minor. All of the churches out of the book of Revelation, seven churches, were in Asia Minor. In this, it's called an isthmus. In this isthmus of land, all the churches of Asia Minor were in there. And Ephesus was one of those churches. What is the point that I'm trying to make? Well, Ephesus is over here. Israel's over here. Israel's the Jewish people, the people of God that were birthed out of Abraham. All these other nations aren't Jews. But as the Apostle Paul travels through the Mediterranean Sea, he begins to preach the gospel, and these various people are getting saved. But he's speaking to them, and he's reminding them that they weren't natural-born Jewish people who were the people that had been given the oracles of God. Do you realize that's what this so? Another thing that's so profound about the nation of Israel, they were the oracle of God, meaning the mouthpiece. God spoke to the people of old through the mouthpiece of his people, which was Israel, through the prophets, through the kings, through the tabernacle and the sacrifices, speaking forth the word of God. And now God, through as the people of God, as Christian, you and I are to be his oracle, his mouthpiece, through which he speaks Amen. Forth the truth of the gospel to a lost and a dying world that has no hope. And he's telling Ephesus, you need to remember where you came from. This is who you were in verse 12. At that time, you were without Christ. Christ meaning the anointed one. The one that the Old Testament promised was coming. You were without him. You were worshiping false gods. You were worshiping Diana. You were worshiping Adonis. You were worshiping all these false gods. You didn't know the first thing about God and his plan of salvation. And many times, even the people that you know, the people that you work with, they say, oh man, I love God. I got a relationship with God. And they don't know no more the truth of what it means to be saved by grace. They don't know, I believe in Jesus. They haven't been born again. And if you haven't been born again, listen to me. If you haven't been born again, received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior in your heart, repented of your sins, and asked the Lord to move in and to take over, then you are not saved and you're not okay with God. You need to hear that this morning before you leave, because you might not come back. And if you never come back, I need to make sure that you were told by a preacher somewhere, somehow, that you must be born again. Jesus told Nicodemus in John chapter 3, unless a man is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God, nor can he enter into the kingdom of God. Make sure you invite Jesus into your heart. Amen. Make sure you ask forgiveness of your sin. I hope you believe what I'm telling you. I can't try to be more convinced than what I am. Holy Spirit, I pray that you would convince the hearts of people, amen, that they would believe in your gospel and that they would learn the hope that you provided for them in Christ. It says this, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens, and that means strangers, from the commonwealth of Israel, meaning God promised Abraham that he would create a nation, and to that nation were his people. He said, you were strangers from the covenants of promise. All the promises that God had given Israel. You didn't know anything about it. You had no hope. And without God in the world, you were hopeless. And without God in the world, you see where I'm going here? That was you at one point in time.
Amen.
That was me at one point in time. Thank God for the person that told you about Jesus. Was it your grandma? Was it your mama? Was it your sister? Was it your friend? Somebody told you about Jesus. Yes. And if they wouldn't have told you, you would have never known. Amen. And the same goes for you. They got people that you know that if you don't tell them about Jesus, they're never going to know. They're aliens from the commonwealth of Christianity. Amen. They don't have the covenants or the promises. It says, but now in Christ Jesus, you who sometimes were far off are made near, nigh by the blood of Christ.
Yes.
You've been made near. Hallelujah. When you put your faith in Jesus, now there's hope. There was no hope before, but now there's hope. For he is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of partition between us. Meaning there used to be Jew and Gentile, but now there's only one. And it's all those that are born again in Jesus Christ. Amen. And he is the hope. But the reason I brought that scripture out is because I wanted to tell you that you used to be without hope. You used to be without hope, and there's people that you were engaging on a daily basis who also are without hope. And sometimes, even though you have the hope of the God of Israel, you have the hope of Jesus, I still find myself in storms and darkness. And sometimes we can begin to feel like we're losing hope. I was going to go to Romans 5, but we don't really have time to do that this morning. But basically in Romans 5, ultimately, the person goes through a trial. The Word of God says, count it joy when you find yourselves in the midst of tribulation. And you know, the word tribulation means to be pressed. Sometimes you find yourself in that storm and you're being pressed. And what it does, though, is it starts a process to take place. The pressing produces something called perseverance. What it means is a steadfastness. See, I don't know how you've been all your life, but you usually got, they talk about in the human that God created, well, they don't say God created, but they say it's animal instinct, but we know God created us. And that within every human being, there's a fight or flight response. That, and it depends, some people are more likely to fight, but even fighters know when it's time to run. You know what I'm saying? And so what I'm trying to say is this, is that there's a fight or a flight response. And when you find yourself in the midst of a situation, amen, you either and the storm is bad and it's dark out there, the reality of it is that you're going to find sometimes you're going to fight against it, amen, and run away from it, or sometimes you will give your heart, amen, and bow your knee to Jesus. And so, but that's what's happening, is that in the midst of that tribulation, you're being pressed, and the question is, are you going to be steadfast? Are you going to run? Are you going to fight? Not just in your own physical strength, because if you try to fight in your own physical strength, you're going to fail. But fight the good fight of faith, keeping your faith in what God provided, which was Jesus dying on the cross, which gives you grace in the midst of your situation, in the midst of your circumstance, to hold on even in the midst of a storm, even in the midst of the trial and the tribulation. It says that in the midst of the tribulation, perseverance comes about. But then it says experience. Another word some translations use is character. It's a proving. You say you're Christian. Okay, guess what? He put Jesus to the test. I'm talking about the enemy. You think he's not going to put us to the test? Yeah. You think he's not asking permission to sift us as wheat? No, he is. Yeah. It's a proving that's taking place. But ultimately, the result is that when it comes through and you trust in God, it produces hope. Yeah. See, even in the midst of your storm, even in the midst of your trial, what ends up happening is even when you're being pressed, you hold on to the Lord and the process moves forward and it produces hope. Why does it produce hope? Let me tell you. Because God proves himself in the midst of the situation. Yeah. And what his word says is true. How you reckon that them people on that boat that were with Paul felt when they ended up on the shore? I think that they were pretty excited that Paul chose to believe the God whom he served, amen, the one that he believed in, that they would all be saved. For poor Paul, it gets even worse because he ended up on an island called Malta. He went to go throw a stick in the fire and a snake bit him. But even then, he didn't swell up and die. And all the people were amazed that the God that he served must be the real God. And God used that to save that whole tribe. Amen. They still got believers on the island of Malta today because of that. Amen. And so I'm just saying that in the midst of all of these situations and all of these circumstances, I just want you to know that God is real. Amen. And that he has a plan for for your life. One last scripture, Romans chapter 15, verse 13. And then I'm going to ask them to come up and maybe play a song for us. And if anybody needs prayer this morning, I just want you to know that the altars are open. Amen? It says, "Now the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost." Now the God of hope. See, He's the one, He's the source that hope comes from. Amen? "Will fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope." The word abound means to have an overabundance. I wrote that down on my Bible this morning. An overabundance, an overflow. I was thinking, man, that's good right there. And when the God of hope begins to put hope in us, and you begin to abound in hope, guess what happens? You get an overflow of hope.
Amen.
That starts overflowing out of you. It's got to go somewhere. It's going to start reaching into the people that are around you. Amen? Hallelujah. He says, through the power of the Holy Ghost. I need you to know that it's the power of the Holy Spirit that allows the hope of God to abound in us and abound out of us. Amen? And it's the power of the Holy Spirit that works in unison with your faith in Jesus. Listen to me. In the book of Revelation, if you'll remember, there was a lamb as though it had been slain. Remember that? John the Beloved, he was on the Isle of Patmos. He had a vision. And in that vision, it said that nobody was worthy to open the seal. You remember that story? And it says that everybody in heaven was weeping. John began to weep. One of the elders said, "Why do you weep? The Lion of the tribe of Judah has prevailed. He is worthy to open the seal." The Bible says John looked, he turned to look. I'm expecting to see a lion, right? Aren't you? That's what he called him. He said, and what he saw was a lamb as though it had been slain. It had seven eyes, which was the seven concept having to do with the Spirit of God. The number seven is completion, fulfillment, perfection.
Amen.
The Spirit of God working in unison with the Lamb of God, the Holy Spirit. The Lamb of God, when your faith is in the finished work of what Christ has done, the Holy Spirit moves in your life. He gives grace to you in the midst of the storm. He gives grace and strength to you no matter what you're going through. And He gives hope to you, an abounding hope, amen, that overflows in you and out of you and begins to reach into those around you.